So now it is my pleasure to introduce our first panelist, Dr. Evelynn Hammonds. Dr. Hammonds is the Barbara Gutmann Rosenkrantz Professor of the History of Science and Professor of African and African American Studies at Harvard University. She's currently chair of the Department of the History of Science. So Dr. Hammonds, we've already heard how trust is dependent on context, especially historical context. And since you study the history of science, can you tell me how you're thinking about your work in the current moment?
Thank you, Erica, and thanks to everyone. I'm happy to be involved in this conversation today. I first have to note that I have a bad cold, so if I start coughing, please, I'll slow down a little bit and hopefully try to get through my remarks. One of the things that I've tried to do, especially since late February, when it became clear that the pandemic was spreading across the United States, and I was aware from my own historical work on the history of epidemic diseases that it would not be long before some of the most marginalized communities in the country would be affected by the outbreak. And the pandemics, as I always say now, pandemics serve as lenses into how a society is structured. Pandemics don't produce inequalities, they reveal inequalities. And so I wanted to use this current moment of the pandemic of COVID-19 to provide sort of historical context on how epidemics in the past had affected African-American communities and to make visible those communities' responses to those epidemics. I also wanted to provide, in a sense, a history of health disparities to try to explain the fact that the burden of health and lack of access to health in particular had fallen upon communities of color across time. And many people didn't know a lot about that history. And then at the end, my work hasn't ended, as none of our work has ended right now, as we proceed through the struggles that we're going through right now in terms of the pandemic, and the issue of vaccines has arisen, and the issues of trust have arisen. Now, many people point to, as Dr. Collins said earlier, to two things when you talk about trust of the medical system and public health system in this country. People talk about the Tuskegee study of untreated syphilis in African-American men as the key, one of the key points that indicate the ways in which African-American communities mistrust medical care and public health experts as well. But I begin in another place. I started a webinar at Harvard over the spring, and in 7 conversations, we walked through some of the history from the 18th century to the present that showed the ways in which African-American communities had been affected by outbreaks of epidemic diseases. And just let me give you 2 examples that I think are pertinent to this conversation. If we begin with what happened at the end of the Civil War, what happened is that the newly freed slaves were literally a refugee population. People did not have jobs, they did not have homes, they did not have land, food, or shelter. At the same time, in that period of time in the 19th century, mid to late 19th century, there was a devastating smallpox epidemic that raged across the South through the period between 1862 and 1868, which, along with the war, produced one of the major biological crises of the 19th century. Thousands of Black peoples and white people as well died in that epidemic. But the real issue is, at first, for the newly freed slaves, the federal government provided some relief, including health services and other kinds of support, because the slaves, the ex-slaves, had no way to provide that support for themselves. But by the 1890s, the government had retreated from organized efforts to support the health of Black people, and Black communities were left to fend for themselves. By the early 20th century, the problems worsened as Black people had limited access to land ownership, to economic opportunities, the living conditions were appalling, and these exacerbated the spread of various kinds of epidemics that occurred during that time, yellow fever, cholera, and such. And because of spatial segregation, and because of poverty, and because of a healthcare system that did not really care for Black communities in particular, it was a very difficult time. And public health practices at the time focused on keeping white people and Black people separate. And Black people were considered to be sources of contagion and not the real recipients of many public health interventions that came to mark the 20th century efforts to control outbreaks of disease. So also by the early 20th century, white public health experts believed that the poor health of Blacks was due to their inferior racial characteristics. And this set in place a kind of sense that Black bodies were different than white bodies. And it's a question that emerges in various ways even until today, and that's something we could talk about later if we want. But when I capture this in the comment that was made in the late 1890s into the early 20th century, Negroes died because they were inferior, one observer said. And he concluded by saying, and they were inferior because they died. And so deep beliefs in racial characteristics that made Black bodies deficient made them more exposed to disease, not the structural issues of poor housing, of lack of job opportunities, of restricted healthcare access, and all of those things. We've been talking about those issues over and over and over again since that time. So health disparities in the 20th century were produced and sustained by practices based on ideologies of racial difference, by the fact that Blacks were not recognized as full citizens, that public health interventions had to protect. And so just this I hope this little short history that I've been able to talk about lets us know that it tells us why it's so important and some important things for us to know about the roots, the deep and long and persistent roots of mistrust within African-American communities that do not begin and end with Tuskegee. They begin and end with constant neglect in a public health infrastructure that has not met the needs of Black communities. And that everyday racism plays a very big role in responses to what is happening for us today. So I think that I'll stop there for the moment.
Thank you, Dr. Hammonds. I want to follow up on one point, knowing that the historical roots of past and current racism and how that leads to inequalities in public health outcomes, what can we take from that? And are there lessons we should take as we're thinking about actions now, grounding ourselves in what has happened in the past?
So I think Dr. Collins touched on it. What the history also shows, and what I try to do when I teach this, is not just the impact of epidemic diseases on African-American communities, but also the long history of health activism in Black communities. That because these communities had to fend for themselves in the times when the federal government and certainly state and local governments would not protect them. So we have to touch that history of health activism that is long present in Black communities, and the trusted community leaders are the ones that I think there are also empirical studies that show are the ones that the community turns to in these kinds of times to validate and support the fact that the vaccines that are being proposed for people to take are safe and efficacious, that we can trust an agency of the government in this particular instance to provide protection and health to the people. But as Dr. Collins says, we're gonna have to have trusted community leaders and professionals within the communities, from health centers, from churches, from other kinds of community organizations to bring that message and to stand by throughout the trials and into the distribution of the vaccines. In the absence of that, I think the long history of racism and the long history of mistrust will out. And we would not like to be in the situation that Dr. Collins described earlier, where this time next year, people are holding back from taking a vaccine that can be useful to them. Excuse me.
Thank you, Dr. Hammonds, and thank you for joining us. Given your cold, I deeply appreciate you making it work and sharing your voice with us, especially when it is you are actively fighting a cold. So I appreciate that.